Yeah. So again, good morning, and welcome to WCQI Cincinnati July edition. All right. I wanted to talk again about cardiac arrest today because I like cardiac arrest. I think cardiac arrest is essentially what EMS, and well, I don't think, it's essentially what the first real EMS units were designed to kind of do. You know, there were like rescue squads or fire departments and that kind of stuff. But in terms of actual care, it was really cardiac stuff, heart attacks, and to some extent cardiac arrest, and the idea of taking a defibrillator out and doing stuff. So cardiac arrest is the EMS disease, and it's the thing that we build systems on, and so it should get some attention from us here. This will not be an ACLS course. I'm not anti-ACLS per se. I took an ACLS class 2 months ago because I had to, sort of thing, and I was screaming at the computer screen by the end of it. However, it's not a bad place to start and ensure that, like, we've got a baseline level of, hey, here's what epinephrine is. Here is this idea of chest compressions. You should think about intubating, et cetera, et cetera. But what I like to do is kind of frame it in the setting of, here's what you would actually do to kind of resuscitate someone in real practice. So I usually call this like the master class sort of stuff. It's really not mastering. It's just kind of a step above ACLS itself. So you may hear some things from me, and this is mostly, as all this is, the opinion of the presenters. It's not necessarily the opinion of UC, and I'm not saying that you shouldn't, that you should do this. You should listen to your medical director. You should follow your protocols, but hopefully this gives you something to think about if you are doing it a little bit differently. And if it's just an operational thing, then maybe that gives you something to think about as well. I initially titled this talk when I first started doing it, new part of new strategies in resuscitation. And you might think like, okay, we're going to do like heads up CPR. Maybe you've seen that where they put a Lucas on him and then get the guy sitting, you know, 45 degrees upright or something like that. Or maybe we're going to start talking about the snap CPR where you do like pauses and you give nitroprusside and you do all this weird kind of stuff to a pig. And then the pig sort of seems to survive a little bit more intact neurologically for the pig. Not talking about any of that stuff. What I want to do is give you something that is implementable in your service potentially today, tomorrow. You could take a recording of this, you could have everybody watch it, theoretically, and maybe come up with a new way to resuscitate somebody in your service, and hopefully use without having to buy a bunch of stuff or without having to you know, really change a lot of the things that you do or the equipment that you bring with you. So this is about the third part of this kind of talk, and I'm going to call this Fix Your Chest Compressions with Friends, because friends are good for everybody. All right, how do we tell people to do chest compressions? It looks something like this, eh? Hopefully, there we go, a little sound here. Now, you can thank the AHA for that. That was probably, you know, $1 million worth of commercial there. what's the message from it? Push fast, push hard, right? And that's great. That's actually fine. You know, it's an interesting commercial. Dr. Ken, the little guy from, God, I'm blanking on it. You'd know him if you saw him. Anyway, he comes on in a minute there, and he like makes some jokes and stuff and talks about CPR and does all that kind of stuff, and it's great. And what's the message again? Push hard, push fast. If you see somebody that is not waking up and not breathing normally, then call 911 and push hard and push fast on their chest. And that's how we tell people to do CPR. And that's okay and probably great for lay people. Why? Because lay people tend not to do CPR at all. They tend to just kind of stand around and not do anything. However, it's really not that simple. Like, if you're just trying to get people to do something, yeah, tell them, just jump on there, push hard, push fast, do all that kind of stuff. However, that's really not the way to get, like, the best chest compression or really great chest compression or the most effective chest compression. This is the criteria that's listed as, like, the best sort of chest compressions. So what you'll see in the recommendations is 100 to 120 compressions a minute. That's the rate. You'll actually deliver probably closer to 80 or 90 of them, something like that. Maybe 100 if you're really hauling and doing really good CPR most of the time. But a rate of 100 to 120 chest compressions a minute. And then you're pushing to a depth of 2 to 2.4 inches. And why is that important? Well, because it's associated with better survival. So if you, there's this green spot in here, this sweet spot where your chest compression rate leads to the best survival, which is over here, and it's right about there. And that actually ends up at a rate of like 124 on the outer aspect or something like that, where the top of that little peak is. But it's 100 to 120 essentially in that bell-shaped curve. If you go too fast, survival, or if you go too slow, survival is not as good. If you go too fast by 20 compressions, survival is also not as good. So we think of like, oh, you got to push faster. Well, if you push too fast, then survival is just as bad as if you push too slow. So in fact, it's maybe a little bit worse. So it's not really push hard, push fast. It's push the right rate. Push between 100 and 120 thereabouts compressions a minute. It's not fast, it's do it right. Same thing with depth, at least to some extent. So we say 2.4 inches, something like that. And again, what's that based on? It's based on survival. There's the line for survival. Chest compression depth is along the bottom here. And you notice again that if you go too much on the deep side, that survival actually tends to kind of tail off a little bit, just as if you didn't push hard enough. And what's that optimum? It's probably somewhere around 1.8, they say. when you get out to where the 2 to 2.4 recommended, it's kind of in that tail end. There is some discrepancy about, like, well, maybe depth on that tail end doesn't actually fall off as much as it looks like. Suffice to say that somewhere around 2 inches seems to be the optimal depth for chest compressions. And if you don't push hard enough, or possibly if you push too hard, that survival goes down for maybe a myriad of reasons. So chest compressions are important to get right. It's not push hard, push fast. It's push, kind of push hard. I mean, it is hard to do, but you don't have to push absolutely as hard as you can, especially if you're a guy that works out, you know, on every shift day, and you got tons of muscles, and you're all lean mass and all that kind of stuff, and you can pound this guy, you know, you can pound his sternum through his spine. You don't have to push as hard as you can, if that's as hard as you can. You have to push right. You have to do it correctly. And then you have to not stop, because that's the other thing that kills people, is when we stop for different reasons. So my question would be, are you doing that? What are you doing in your service? And this is, let's take a couple of representative videos here. Let me get me out of the way for just a second. Here is a couple of resuscitations. And this is all patient compliant, or HIPAA compliant, all that kind of stuff, because he's a dummy. So here's one. You see him at the upper left. Here's another resuscitation. And here's a third one. Now look at those for a second and tell me which one is right, or which one is the best. Who's doing the best chest compressions? What's the rate? What's the depth? Are they doing a lot of leaning on the chest? You know, throw it in there, but what about BVM? What about the bagging rate and that kind of stuff that's going along with it? How's that going? Can you really tell? Do you know? Now, I would say that question, when you really pose it to people, that's a hard thing for most of us to answer. Even if you're standing there watching it, it's still hard to tell. You know, what the rate, what the depth is, they're leaning, what's the quality of compressions are from our standpoint. And most of us, when you ask this question to somebody in your service, like, hey, what's your overall, for every cardiac arrest, what's your overall chest compression fraction? How much time are you actually doing CPR? What percentage of CPR are you doing well, even, without being too shallow or too fast? And most of us have this as the answer. Think about it a second. Get it? No idea. I thought it was funny. most of us don't really know. Right? Some of us do. But by and large, most of us don't really know, looking backwards retrospectively, as well as when it's happening, if we're doing good chest compressions. And, you know, just to, again, take an example here. Here's these three things that are going on here. let's just look at the rate. This guy is going at 168 beats per minute. This gal is going 152 beats per minute, and this person, even though they look like they're not going nearly as fast, is going at 140 beats per minute. So all too fast, don't take it the wrong way, but inappropriate chest compressions, inappropriate rate. And we know that the faster you go, the kind of worse things are. So when you're doing this stuff, you need somebody to kind of watch you, to help. This is available on some monitors, so like Physio makes the little puck that you can put on the chest. I think it's Physio. Zoll has this CPR sort of dashboard where it's got this thing that tells you the depth as long as you're using the right pads, which are three times as expensive as the regular pads. And then there's the rate of chest compressions. And then there's this thing about, you know, here's actually how good your chest compressions are. And it yells at you if you don't disable the thing, if you push harder, that kind of stuff. That's out there. And you can do that and monitor your chest compressions that way. But again, my goal is not for you to have to buy something. And even if you do have this, in this case, here we are, this resuscitation, they actually have that. Here's the monitor over here. That is on the monitor. I know because I was watching it. That's there. And yet the rate of chest compressions is still off. The depth is still not great. And they won't do a full 2 minutes of chest compressions. Even if you have the thing to monitor you, and here I'm getting to the actual point, I promise. It's all just background up to now's the time to pay attention. Even if you have something watching you do it, a feedback device, if you are doing chest compressions, it is my assertion that you can't really focus on what that thing is saying and look at that little thing and still do good or effective chest compressions. The way I like to think of it is sort of like this. Here's mission control. I think this was for Apollo 11. And look, all these people, this is everybody involved with it. Everybody's got a computer screen. Everybody's got data. all these folks are out there making the thing work. However, there's only one guy that ever talks to the crew itself. You don't hear from each of those guys at a computer terminal because then it becomes all just noise. And in fact, you don't even hear from the mission commander, who's right here. You hear from this guy, who's called the Capcom. And this is a gentleman that is also an astronaut, or trains with astronauts. And the idea is that he is a communicator and a liaison for the crew. So the crew doesn't get any messages other than the guy who's filling this role. And what that lets them do is it stays quiet, and he can put it in terms that they understand or that makes sense to them, rather than what the engineers and the flight commander are saying. information's great, but you have to be able to make that in a form that the operator can actually use in order to make that information pertinent. So where am I going with this? We've got all these folks that are involved in the resuscitation, and I know this isn't the way that things look out of the hospital, but this is just what you have, you know, played up and easy to graphicize. You have all these folks, and we've got to get certain information to this one person that's doing chest compressions. And I would argue that the way to do that, because he's usually not going to see the monitor, he's usually not going to be able to tell about that feedback device. The way that we can make our chest compressions a lot better, because we know what they're supposed to be, it's just a question of operationalizing it, is to bring a sheepdog into the room. Now, what's a sheepdog do? What am I talking about? Here are some sheep, and they're all going from one pasture to another. And that's pretty cool, right? How do these, you know, hundreds of sheep get told where to go? Because sheep are dumb creatures. Sheep would never actually do this on their own, outside of maybe instinct. What's this down here? This little tiny black dot is a sheepdog. And he is encouraging, without like actually touching the sheep, encouraging them to get into those other other areas. And he'll go back and he'll round stuff up and keep an eye on the sheep and get them moving in the right direction. And that's what I mean by CPR sheepdog. I like the way of saying that a little bit better. Now, I noticed that when I did that ACLS class the other day, I've been talking about this for about 3 or 4 years, and I think actually put it out there a while ago. In the 2020 update, AHA now starts talking about using a CPR coach. Again, okay, cool. I've been saying it for a couple of years. In fact, brought it up at an AHA conference, and I'm not saying they stole it, but anyway. Did I say that? No, kidding. this came up, and now they start teaching this idea of a CPR coach, but it's not really out there very well, in my opinion. So let's talk about it real fast, maybe kind of fast. When you look at CPR, CPR is a very physical thing. This is actually an exercise class doing chest compressions. This seems like a super boring exercise class, but okay, fine. Everybody's got their thing. But these guys are just doing chest compressions on these balls. It's a really hard thing to do. It is essentially an athletic activity. Now, some of us may be able to do chest compressions for 2 minutes at a time. I'll argue not many of us. But if you practice a lot, like I will say that I think I can do about 2 minutes of really effective chest compressions, because I spent like 3 years essentially just teaching this stuff and just doing chest compressions like on a weekly basis. So I got pretty good at it, and, you know, developed the svelte physical physique that you see before you now. But here's what most people do when you hand them a dummy or a person and say, do 2 minutes of chest compressions. You get about 30 seconds of okay chest compressions down here, just to read this. These are, you know, push down, and if you hit that green bar, that's 2 inches, and the bottom part is 2.4 inches. So most people get about 30 seconds of okay chest compressions, and then it falls off. And these are not like weaklings that are doing it. These are strong. I think this was like a big like gym-going medical student. and yet you don't get 2 minutes of good chest compressions. You get about maybe 15, 30 seconds of it that start off, and then things sort of tend to fall off. So between those arrows, that's where the effective, great, good, appropriate chest compressions end. You see the same thing here. Here's a switch to a different person. Here's 2 more minutes of chest compressions, and you see maybe 2 of them hit the depth bar, and then they just sort of fall off throughout. Now, good effort down here, almost there, but no, never mind. We never do actually make it back, and so our depth is way low, and then the rate ends up being faster too. And you know, if you want to throw in some other stuff with it, how about that BVM rate? It's going pretty quick here. I think they end up bagging at a rate of like 50 a minute, if I calculated those correctly, in the middle. Is anybody watching that? How do you know? And these are folks that are in a class with me at that point that I am saying, hey, watch out for your chest compression rate, watch out for your BVM rate. Here's a switch to yet a third person where, again, we hit it for almost 30 seconds and then it falls back off. And we never get back to good chest compressions again. That's again, folks in the hospital. This is when we took it out to firefighters and had them do it. You still see that firefighters, these are big, you know, big guys that have plenty of physical ability to do it. They do about 30 seconds of good chest compressions, and then again it falls off. And 30 seconds of good chest compressions, and then it falls off. And then they get this guy who just rocked it out. That may have been me, actually. I can't remember. That'd be a jerk of me to take credit for it, but also he's going too fast based on that. Anyway, so it doesn't necessarily have to do with your size per se. It's about whether or not you practice it. In this case, you see the depth ends up okay, but then it never comes back up to the end. So the guy is leaning on the chest. It never goes back up to the top. So we see that happening at the end of 2 minutes. That's about 30 seconds of that. Leaning on the chest by even like 0.2 inch is enough to decrease their coronary perfusion pressure and their cerebral perfusion pressure enough that you won't get ROSC. Whoops. Get on out there. There we go. There's that just zoomed in. And here's what it is on actual people. You see the exact same thing. This is chest compression depth. Go the other direction. They're trying to get high at this point. And folks start off, you know, full of spit and vinegar, and almost universally it falls off by the end of about a minute. Nobody's doing effective chest compressions anymore. It's just like your pulse check. Look at this example. We have the ability to do good chest compressions. We have the ability to get a pulse check done in 4 to 5 seconds, but here's the average pulse check. Everybody's seen this happening, right? And when you're watching it, you're like, oh my God, what is taking so long? Why don't they just shock this guy or get back on the chest or do something? And ultimately, before this guy gets a meaningful chest compression, it's about 20, 21 seconds. Come on there. Slide's not advancing. There we go. Oh, no. Don't tell me we have to do that again. All right. Well, anyway, we can, and later on I'll show you the video, I think, that does actually show this. It is possible to do this pulse check and this whole thing in about 5 seconds or so. But what do you need to do it? You need organization, and you need somebody that is responsible for it. And that's where the sheepdog comes in. Sorry, it's almost done. Advance. There we go. The sheepdog. The addition of a coach can really help your team rise to the occasion rather than fall down to their most base level of training, which is an ACLS class, which has terrible chest compression, depth and rate and all that kind of stuff, despite it being a class. Anyway, think of the CPR guy, sheepdog, coach, whatever you want to call it, as the guy who is not the team leader. He is there to make sure that the chest compressions happen, and that needs to be his only job. And when you add that coach, you go from this to this, which is good chest compressions throughout. There's no leaning. This is a pulse check here, or a compressor switch, rather. And then even though you see that, we're sort of getting marginal chest compressions, with the addition of that coach, you actually find that you get good chest compressions after that. along with that, this guy can help sort out pulse checks rather than... Let's see if this is the one that actually has it. When we can get all this stuff done, if you add that guy in and make it his job to say, all right, you're going to coordinate who's doing X, Y, or Z during this pulse check so there's actually somebody doing it, and then the team leader can do like the rhythm analysis and give the actual order, now we get that pulse check done in about 4 or 5 seconds. The other thing this takes a little more than me just kind of talking to you about it. You do have to kind of practice it. You have to figure out how that person works, but I'm trying to give you ideas. in terms of using like the feedback on the monitor, again, most people that are doing chest compressions, even if they have the monitor right in front of them, they can't really look at it or they can't really make sense of it because they're doing this very physical activity. They're doing this thing that is really hard to do and they need to focus on that. And so even if you have the thing in front of you that's flashing lights and stuff, most people don't respond to it. If it's right in front of you, most people still don't. And most of the time, the monitor is, of course, behind you or it's like off to the side. And the guy that's doing chest compressions is trying to look over there, but probably he totally forgets about it because he's just focused on, you know, wailing on this guy's chest, which is mostly appropriate. So the thing that CPR coach or the CPR sheepdog or whatever you want to call him can do is look at the monitor, and he can interpret it because his only job is to make sure the chest compressions are good, not to do the physical activity, but to help you do it appropriately. So he can say, hey, a little deeper, good, yes, good, good, a little slower, slow down a little bit, a little deeper still, good, good, good. And you would think that that's kind of obnoxious, and it is if you do it the wrong way. But the CPR sheepdog, that guy, has the job of watching what's happening on the monitor and liaisoning from the team and the monitor in terms of what needs to happen for the chest compressor himself. And that way the chest compressor isn't trying to listen to everybody else as well as the monitor tell him what to do when he's doing this really hard physical thing. How about the use of the metronome with it? Maybe you're hearing that clicking. There we go. You hear that? That's a metronome that's going at 100 beats per minute. We can increase it to 120 and whatever we want. But if you just turn on a metronome, which I've done before in a resuscitation, just like turn it on and say, okay, chest compressor, follow this. You know what the chest compressor does? Nothing. Keeps doing exactly what he's doing. Because most of us can't really follow along with that very well because we're trying to do something really physical and it's hard to get on that beat with it. But if you add the coach to say, okay, here comes the beat. Click, 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 click. Click. Well, if you add a person, it makes it much easier for that next person to fall in line with them. and again, there is a metronome ongoing in this resuscitation right here. It's next to the monitor, actually, there. It's pretty loud. It's clicking. Everybody knows it's there, but everybody just thinks it's annoying. And the guy still doesn't line up with it. It's just a metronome clicking in the background unless you have somebody getting them coordinated on it. A director, a sheepdog, a coach, whatever you want to call it. The last thing that I'm going to say this person can do, well, one of two things. One is that they can fix the big pauses, which are the unintentional pauses. Like a lot of us know when a pulse check is coming up and we can kind of get ready for that if we're thinking about it. We still tend to not think about it very much, and there's still these big, you know, 30-second pauses when it should be really, you know, on-off, shock within 5 seconds of stopping, and then immediately back on the chest. It still takes us sometimes 20, 30 seconds to get that thing done. But there's also these unintentional pauses. Like I showed you before, how much CPR do most people have in them, realistically? It's about 60 seconds. Most people do CPR effectively for about 60 seconds at the longest, and then they stop. For whatever reason, they don't realize it, or they forget about it, or they stop paying attention. So you got about 60 seconds of CPR in you. we should probably switch every 60 seconds because most of us aren't able to do, physically are not able to do 2 minutes of actual CPR. The problem is if you try to switch, you try to tell people you need to switch chest compressors every 60 seconds, then you say, well, that's going to leave this big pause in here. That's going to be 20, 30 seconds where we're off the chest because we're switching chest compressors. We can't do that. And I would say, well, that's the role of this guy, your CPR coach, because he can line up somebody else to do chest compressions behind him. Maybe it's not that guy, maybe it's this guy. But he can line up the next chest compressor without the chest compressor having to worry about it. The other thing he can do is when hands come off the chest, this guy, being a sheepdog and paying attention, has one job, and that is to make sure that his hands get back on the chest. So he can actually fill in, whenever there is a pause, if this person slips or this person falls or this person needs a break, he'll jump in and do 20, 30 chest compressions while the next person is getting in line. And then you can make an effective transition. All right, I'm doing chest compressions. All right, Bill, you ready? Okay, I'm going to come off in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, all you. And then he can go back to monitoring chest compression. So he fills in those unintentional gaps, which again, sometimes will take 20, 30 seconds to fill, which is horribly detrimental to someone's survival if you got 5 or 6 pauses where there's 30 seconds where they're not getting chest compressions on top of everything else. So that's what that guy can do. The last thing I'm going to bring up, and this is really one of the important jobs of it, I think, is that he can keep up the chatter. He can talk to the guy that's doing chest compressions, and the guy that's doing chest compressions doesn't have to listen to everybody else. Think of it this way. If you're sitting there, all right, good chest compressions, good chest compressions, good chest compressions, good, good, good. Push a little harder, harder, harder. Great. Yes, yes, yes. Good, good. It helps psych that other person up. And again, this is a physical activity. There is an element of adrenaline that we need to keep in there. Think of it this way. If I hand you a bowling ball and say, throw it down the lane, and you throw it, and you knock down, 3 pins or something like that, and then I put a screen in front of you and say, all right, throw it again. Okay, do you know where to hit it? If you can't see the pins, do you know where to throw the next one after that, and the next one after that? You kind of need a continuous feedback. You need to know what the situation is at essentially all times when you're doing something kind of physical. And what that guy can do is help you to see which, or is help you to maintain that quality of CPR. So he can look at this tracing and say, okay, push harder, push harder, push harder. Yeah, yeah, good, something like that. He can keep that up. He'll be able to keep and push you and encourage you through into doing good chest compressions. Because again, I think a lot of the time, especially if we're in like an EMS service or fire service, it's not so much that the guy is truly exhausted, although it might be, but more often we just don't realize it. We kind of get mentally lazy and we stop focusing on it, and that guy is there to keep your attention on it. Yes, yes, good, 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 that kind of stuff. So again, this is probably an hour and a half thing to talk about because you probably need to workshop this and you need to try it out and stuff, but hopefully this gives you something to kind of think about as you come around and do your next ACLS refresher and somebody says, oh, you should have a CPR coach. And you're like, okay, let's actually make that an effective thing instead of just something that we pay lip service to because I had to do it to answer on the test, which I think is what it gets relegated to. It is a really helpful thing. It will really improve the quality of CPR if done correctly. So in summary, you need to adjust, I think, opinion of Walt Lubbers, MD, you should adopt a CPR sheepdog. And you need to give him one job to do. And just like a true sheepdog, he needs to be nervous. That guy needs to be nervous if there is any pause in CPR. Because, again, Bill's the CPR sheepdog for this one. Bill's the CPR coach. Bill, what's your job? Compressions are always happening. That's what his job is. And if the compressions are not happening, then he needs to be nervous. He needs to be kind of like getting at it. All right, all right, fine, I'll do it. And go ahead and fill in those gaps and make sure that effective compressions are always there. This is a guy that can make pulse checks happen and coordinate everything, because if the guy that's really running the team leader, he should be doing things like, let's analyze stuff, let's look at the monitor, let's talk to the family, and let's figure out that kind of stuff and synthesize data rather than operationally making things happen. And then this guy can keep up the chatter and keep everybody excited about doing the CPR, doing the chest compressions.